Thanks everybody for showing up. We got a good turnout already, so I'm excited and optimistic. And thank you, Goat Hulu, for your ongoing support. Very much appreciated. So today I'm going to play the Arena Qualifier event. Let me see if I can show you what that's all about. It is a two-day event, and the objective is to go 7-1 on day one in order to qualify to play tomorrow. So I'm going to record this as a video for the Channel Fireball YouTube channel, which means you're going to get every match, win, lose, or draw, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I could just lose twice and be out immediately, or we could get as many as 7 or 8 rounds on day one plus a day two. Who knows? I can't tell ahead of time, which is part of the fun. It's the Explorer format, and I'm relatively new to Explorer, as I'm sure you will learn throughout the course of the matches. But I asked my teammate, Gabriel Nassif Yellow Hat, for a deck because he's been playing a lot. And this one seemed right up my alley. It's I'm calling it Black Green Toughies because it's just literally a big creature theme deck where the goal is to have creatures with, you know, 5, 6, 7 power to utilize Fight Rigging and the Great Henge. You know, black and green are my colors, so I thought this was would be a pretty good, like, straightforward entry point for the format. So, yeah, that's what I've got for today. Before we get into the matches, let me give a shout-out to my two excellent sponsors. The first is, of course, Channel Fireball. I work very hard on our offerings for Channel Fireball Pro, and every day we're expanding our library of knowledge and content. So I do want to stress that, you know, if you decide to sign up for Channel Fireball Pro, it's not just that you're getting our weekly deck guides. You're immediately on day one getting access to years of backlog, deep dive contents, content, you know, information about any deck in any format, hopefully, that you're interested in. So I think it is, you know, if you're a competitive Magic player or somebody who's looking to hone their craft, something that you should consider. And there's lots of subscription options that might fit for you. So if you do decide to sign up for CFP Pro or shop on the marketplace, consider using my affiliate code READ, R-E-I-D. That helps me out, and I do appreciate it. Then thanks also to Ultimate Guard for helping make this possible. They're releasing some new products, hopefully in early July, including the Boulder Entree deck box. So yeah, keep an eye as well on Ultimate Guard's website and online catalog in case anything's interesting to you. All right, let's see what we can do in this Arena Qualifier event. Am I going to be in Vegas for Magic's for the Magic 30th anniversary celebration? I am. Not only am I going to be there, but that's that event is host to the World Championships, so I'll be there as a competitor. Yeah, that looks like a good start. I could tell just by looking at the deck list that the hands where you start with Llanowar Elves are going to be way better than the hands where you don't, just because basically all the cards in this deck cost, well, not literally all the cards in this deck, but a huge number of the cards in this deck cost 3 mana. So the difference between going like nothing creature versus turn 1 elf, turn 2 big creature, that should be a huge deal. All right, well, I'm on the draw against Mono Red. I'm hoping that I have the tools to do well in this matchup since, you know, my deck literally has 4 copies of the Great Henge in the main deck. But, you know, on the draw against a good hand from Mono Red, there's no guarantees here. MK Toma, thank you so much for subscribing. 10 months is awesome. Lot of creatures. Thankfully, the Shakedown Heavy is pretty strong on blocking. Like, the option to remove it from combat is only when I attack. And Yukon 83, thank you also for the sub. You guys are supporting me in my lowest moment as I'm really getting creamed in this game. This is like, I'm getting embarrassed. How about one more Shakedown Heavy? Is that enough to save me? Okay, well, definitely bringing in Fatal Push. I know that much. Scavenging Ooze, Culling Ritual, that all seems good. Then I'm going to guess I don't want Thoughtseize. And then some of these other cards, like Infernal Grasp, Shaper Sanctuary, Crawl Harpooner, those are going to be maybes. See if Yellow Hat gave me any advice for this. No, he didn't give me a sideboard guide for Mono Red. So, what else? Maybe Fight Rigging is a little slow. Maybe Ronus and Kiora, Valky. Yeah, something like that. I think the elves are too good to cut. You know, definitely when I'm on the play. Though, I don't know if this particular opponent has Goblin Chain Whirler, but that can be a beating. Sure, so I'll keep, and then probably just Forest Heart's Desire. If I do that, it probably means I'm going to have to shock myself at a later time with the Overrun Tomb, but it seems worthwhile. Nice, I got the impenetrable defense this time. Do you guys think play draw matters a lot in this matchup? Based on the way these games have gone? Zero Coin, thank you for your ongoing support. So I could start by attacking with Pack Leader and Lovestruck Beast. Like if I draw a fourth land and play either Henge or Collected Company, I probably am not going to lose from there. And then failing that, I just play Registrar, which is hard to attack through anyway. Sure, so they're going to take away my human token, which means I can't attack with Lovestruck Beast. I guess this is still a fine attack. Like, there's no way they're, my opponent's going to be able to attack through Registrar and Lovestruck Beast. Yikes. So my thinking here is that if my opponent trades a 2-2 with the pack leader, I'm fine with that. If they block with Torbran, I can just pump. And, you know, without Torbran on the battlefield, there's no way my opponent's going to be able to win this game. And in any case, like, getting the extra card draw is just pretty nice. Ding, ding, ding. Just add 14 power to the battlefield and draw 2 cards. Okay, so, man, Infernal Grasp hurts, but maybe I want one or two to deal with Torbran or like an Embercleaved creature. Might just be sort of necessary evil. Don't think I can keep a hand without a play before turn 3, so 6, 7, 8... 16, 19. Okay, I guess I have plenty of cheap plays with this configuration. Should I start cutting, like, trimming into the fight riggings or the shakedown heavies? Collected Company actually seems pretty good. I think Kiora is too bad. Like, here's my thinking, right? I just need to have a big creature on the battlefield to stabilize my life total. So I don't want to play cards, too many cards that also need me to have a big creature, right? Like too many like Kioras, Henges, fight riggings. Obviously Henge is like, that's how I'm going to win. That's the best one in this matchup. So I'm not intending to cut any of those, but I just want to be a little bit careful with having too many fight riggings, Kioras, and Ronuses in addition to the Henges. Maybe like this or something. Henge is good enough, it's important enough to draw one Henge that I'm willing to have four, even though it's legendary and bad to draw in multiples. Just want to see one every game. Like I said, I think that's how I win. No, the Harpooner is not to kill flyers. It's just to be a card that I can play on turn two and trade with something. Wow, no one drop. That's a stroke of luck for me. I know from playing Modern that you gotta block the Ragavan. Well, it's pretty scary if Embercleave gets in the mix. I guess Boseiju might wind up being good against Embercleave. Hey, Tommy GG, thank you so much for your ongoing support. All right. Maybe I can just get lucky and draw the Great Henge right here. Interesting. Well, I feel like Boseiju is a pretty high value card because it can kill Anax or it can protect me against Embercleave, though it seems like my opponent didn't have Embercleave from the way they played that turn. So I guess I could just play Ooze and shock myself, and then hopefully the opponent will think I'm just shocking myself because of the Ooze. I guess I should just kill the Anax, right? No, I mean, I guess I could just use the Ooze. Take 9 and use Ooze. Nah, I don't know. 9 damage is a lot. All right. Well, that kind of stinks, but it would have gotten me regardless, because even if I didn't use Boseiju, I would have just end of turn tried to eat two things with the ooze, and my opponent could have responded by finishing it off. Gotta draw something now, though. Henge or another ooze. It's not helpful. Help. Probably just dead on board, right? I think I could have won this game if I, like... What I like to say is if I had X-ray glasses, if I knew every card in my opponent's hand, I probably could have found a way to win this game by just making a giant ooze. But... I think the way I played with the block and the Boseiju was like reasonable in the light of uncertainty, not knowing what the opponent had. All right, well, let's try to right the ship. Starting off with a loss does not bode well for the seven wins prospect, but take heart. Karizev has menace, so the only way you can block it is if you block with two creatures. So, interesting. I could see a case for bottoming the elves and then going like Thoughtseize, pack leader, or I could see bottoming a pack leader, going turn one elves, and then maybe turn two Thoughtseize, pack leader. I'll just bottom the elves. Is that right? No, it's probably not right. Yeah, I'll bottom the elves. Man, again. Well, kind of glad I bottomed the elves because my opponent has 100 ways to kill it. Take Reckless Rage and then just hope to stabilize with Pack Leader. Why am I playing one collected company? Well, I think the idea is if you add more collected companies, you have to cut creatures, which then weakens collected company. So playing with one is sort of like the optimal point where collected company is at its most powerful. Yeah, this is pretty much Yellow Hat's list. Well, it would be nice if I get to just attack with two werewolf pack leaders and draw two cards. I don't know how likely that is. I think a lot of draws, you want to just play Rotting Regisaur as quickly as possible because it's your best card. But in this case, I have the luxury of emptying my hand before playing the Regisaur. Okay, so imagine I play land, I attack with the two pack leaders, opponent, I draw two cards, opponent blocks one with Annex, I pump. So now we trade, you get two satyrs, but then I'm taking a big hit on the back, on the crack back. I think that's worse than just playing Rotting Regisaur. I don't love the idea of waiting around forever because it allows my opponent to assemble like Embercleave plus Annex. But I'd rather just make the play that's good against the board. Well, I like that my opponent's thinking, because usually when somebody has Embercleave, they just attack, they just click the attack all button as quickly as possible. Okay, now I think I would like to attack with definitely the two pack leaders, the Regisaur also, or no? Probably just the pack leaders. So I'm thinking my opponent probably wants to block one with Annex, and then if I pump, they use Stomp plus Firebrand to kill it and like kind of tempo me. But it's not even that bad because I do get the Firebrand off the battlefield. All right, I'll bite here. Make them use it. Okay, that could have been a lot worse. Yeah, the ooze. Strangely enough, there's not a lot of creatures in the graveyard because of the etchings, but still, let's play out my hand and I'm feeling pretty good. Yeah, I don't think it's really time to start attacking. So there's currently exactly one creature in the graveyard. Man, I still don't love my attacks. Well, I guess I can attack with at least one creature and then be able to untap it with Kiora. Do I think they'll trade the Anax for a Regisaur? Okay, yeah, let's get in with the Regisaurus, and then I can untap one with Kiora. Yep. It's true that if I wait around and draw the Great Henge, I'm in really good shape, but you know, if you're able to win with just what you have on the board, it's better to do that and not leave anything up to chance. Like, you know, if you play too passively in a winning position, then your opponent can just outdraw you over the course of a few turns. Or, like, if they just find Embercleave or Torbran, this situation becomes a lot scarier very quickly. So the etchings only exiles... It effectively only exiles my creatures.
the back. I love to make a splash.
Sometimes when you have two oozes, it's like a little bit unclear if you want to balance them or just make one enormous. Or, you know, not use them at all so that you put that decision off for a later turn. Uh-oh. And making this attack without the Den of the Bugbear is especially scary. So a cleave would make this 16 damage. But I can gain some life. But probably I need to block that with more than the 1-1 if I want to play around Embercleave. I mean, like, putting the Registrar in front of the Annax makes sense, sort of. Oh no! Oh, I just died to the board when I could have eaten something with ooze. That's not good. That was not a good play. I could have drawn like Boseiju, or if I had drawn a big creature, then I get to draw off the Kiora to have another shot at it. Ugh. By the way, I might be setting the world record for the shortest Channel Fireball gameplay video here if I just go do two matches and out. So what would have happened if I'd eaten with the ooze? I'd survive it to life. I guess because my creatures are exiled, probably just the most likely outcome is my opponent untaps and kills me with Ramunap Ruins. So I think it would have taken something pretty special for me to get out of that. But I still need to play sharper if I want to do well in this event. This is a great hand. It's probably right for me to just not even play the ooze because of the culling ritual. Also, like, a lot of people are in chat are saying, like, I should have blocked, basically assuming my opponent has Embercleave. I don't think that's true. I think, like, my opponent had zero cards in a sort of desperate situation, drew and attacked with everything. So I think you want to maximize as best you can for both the situations where they have Embercleave and the situations where they just have like Bone Crusher Giant or something. You know, like maybe my opponent was just making a desperation attack with the intent to finish off the Regisaur afterwards and like maybe play a bit of a longer game. So, you know, you have to prepare for like a range of outcomes there. Even though Embercleave, of course, is the worst one. So yeah, I'm just going to go ahead and not play the ooze with the intent to culling ritual later. Yeah, it's true my opponent didn't attack with Den of the Bugbear, but that was a Kumano Chapter 2 turn, so they could just be playing a creature post-combat. Or I thought that, you know, probably Embercleave is the single most likely outcome, most likely situation, and then the second most likely situation is that they just have a burn spell to finish off the Rotting Regisaur. But I think that attack makes a lot of sense if they had drawn Bone Crusher Giant, because then they get to stomp a weakened creature and then play the Bone Crusher post-combat, and then the game continues. Okay, so I think I'll just not use Fatal Push. I think I want to make them have something. If they have Embercleave, any of these creatures can kill the Regisaur with Embercleave, so this is probably the best block anyway. I guess if I'm certain they have Embercleave, I should probably block, like, the etchings. But if they have Reckless Rage, then this is the best block. Right, so definitely playing Culling Ritual, and then the question is, do I want to use the mana to play the ooze, or maybe wait to play around a burn spell? I'll just play the ooze. Sure. Hey, what's up, Yellow Hat? I'm playing Yellow Hat's Green Black Toughies list, though I did include the spicy culling ritual because I saw it in one of, it wasn't in Yellow Hat's recommended version, but one of it, the previous versions that he had played. And I was like, oh, that's too much fun to not play with. Okay. Guess I'm just killing this and attacking. Yellow Hat, would you like to weigh in on my sideboarding game three on the draw against Mono Red? Ronus is good. All right, I'll do one grasp. At first I had no grasps, but I think it's sometimes you have to kill the Embercleave. Sometimes the game just hinges on being able to kill the Embercleave creature or Torbran or Anax or something. So I'll play one. Okay, Ronus is good against Embercleave. That's a good point. All right, let's do it. Will I advance, or will this be the shortest gameplay video ever? Okay, I can win with this hand. This has everything I need. Man, it's just so good to have Fatal Push in this matchup. If I had known I was going to play against Mono Red twice, I probably would have I mean, just played any other removal spell besides Infernal Grasp, but Fatal Push is uniquely good. The video length on YouTube is going to spoil the result. I'll have them include like 10 hours of Darth Vader's Imperial March after the gameplay ends, so that nobody's spoiled for the result. All right. Does it matter at what point I've cast Fatal Push? I guess I'll do it like beginning of combat step in case they have Robber of the Rich. So option A is fight rigging, and then Shakedown Heavy can hopefully get the fight rigging to pop off next turn. Option B is to play the Shakedown Heavy, which is much better if it that's amazing if it untaps, because then I get to play the Henge and the fight rigging. But if they have Reckless Impulse, which is a card that I think is somewhat likely for them to have. I mean, the fight rigging, I guess, would only work out better if they tap out. So I'll just try not to overthink it, and I'll play the Shakedown Heavy. I guess if they boarded in, like, Lava Coil or something. Chat seems to want me to play fight rigging, so... And then I guess I'll attack. I don't think I'm gonna want to trade off the bees under these circumstances. Well, accurately predicted that one. Not sure if I necessarily made a good play given my opponent having that, but we'll see. Sure. Well, pretty much hoping my opponent doesn't have Embercleave or Torbran at this point. Lovestruck Beast is a nice draw. I cannot get Great Henge onto the battlefield this turn, but I can just play Heart's Desire and Lovestruck Beast. Embercleave would make this into a 5-4 double strike, so I guess making a 6-6 love struck beast is a good idea. Yeah, that's scary. Okay, so my instinct is this, which would have me taking 9. Alternatively, that has me taking 6 plus 7 is 13. But I kill one more satyr. I think this is probably what I have to do. Yes. Okay. All right, so if I use Fight Rigging first, then the Henge is going to cost me 2 mana, but I won't draw off Ronus. If I play Henge first, then I get the draw off Ronus. I probably want to wind up like cycling through the Henge and just putting as many creatures on the battlefield as possible. I don't think it's really going to be in the cards for me to be able to block with the Lair. But let's say 3 mana, play Henge. Then I get a counter on the beast, play the Ronus, draw a card. Post combat, I have 4 mana to do Heart's Desire and Lovestruck Beast and cycle through another Henge. Yeah, I don't think Lair is going to do anything, so I think that is what I want to do. Okay, so now well, this is just definitely happening no matter what, right? I think I'm going to play this. I think I'm more likely to want the mana between like the Ronus ability and the Henge and the Lair of the Hydra. So the reason I chumped the Annex rather than killing another token is I would have to take multiple hits from the token before it would deal more damage than like jumping the Annex for one turn. And I just don't think the game is going to go that long, or like, well, I don't think the game is going to be like in a contest for that long, put it that way. So if my opponent has Cleave here, this becomes an 8 power double strike, and then each hit deals 10 damage. So I'd have to put a lot of toughness to survive that. This can also become effectively 10. So I'm guessing I'm dead to Embercleave, though I haven't checked everything. But like, for example, if I let Torbran and a token go unblocked, then I'm dead to Embercleave on the Torbran. And if I don't put at least 8 toughness on the Annex, then I'm dead to Embercleave on the Annex just on its own. So I think this is not going to go well for me. If I do like this, if a token gets cleaved, then that's 11 as well. So that doesn't work. So yeah, I'm not seeing a way that I beat Embercleave here. If I leave 2 tokens unblocked, then it's 8 from the Embercleave token plus 3 is 11. So like, there's no combination of blocks here where I'm not dead to Embercleave, unfortunately. All right. 0-2. Well, that was a quick one, folks.